After his tour of duty and serving our country, he earned his doctorate degree from the University of California, Berkeley. Pretty prestigious college, university. So he attends West Point Military Academy. He serves in the Armed Forces as an officer during World War II. After his service in the military, he earns his doctorate degree from the University of California, Berkeley. And he taught psychology at the university until he moved on to Harvard University. So he gets his degree from University of California, Berkeley. After he gets his doctorate degree, he begins to teach psychology at the university. And then moves on to a promotion to become a professor at Harvard University in psychology, obviously. Now, I got in a little bit of trouble at Harvard. He's a psychologist, right? Well, what he did is he began to conduct psychological experiments with drugs in the late 50s and 60s. In other words, I guess that wasn't as big a deal because that was actually legal for him to do. So what Larry did is he conducted legal psychological experiments with drugs in the late 50s and early 60s. How did you do those? Who do you think he gave the drugs to? He gave them to animals and himself, probably, to do these legal experiments. When did they become illegal in 1963? He did them with his students. Very good. So during the late 50s and early 1960s, he was conducting legal psychological experiments with drugs on animals and possibly himself. Well, in 1963, it was found that he was using students in his classes for research, so he got fired. Well, what did he do after he got fired from Harvard? He became the leading spokesman and advocate of LSD. So he gets fired in 1963 for using his students in his psychological experiments with drugs, and later becomes the most outspoken advocate of LSD. He goes on to found what was known as the League for Spiritual Discovery. He founded an organization called the League for Spiritual Discovery. So after he's fired from Harvard, he goes on and he forms what is known as the League for Spiritual Discovery. And that was in upstate New York. And what the League for Spiritual Discovery was simply a group of religious followers who followed him. Okay? So the League for Spiritual Discovery simply was a congregation of religious followers who believed in what Leary was teaching. Now, when you go to church, every church is different. Do your churches have a time when possibly the minister, the priest, or the bishop, or whoever says, let's stand and pass the peace and say hi to your neighbors? Most churches do that. Well, Timothy Leary did that too. The difference was they passed marijuana joints to each other during the passing of peace. Okay? So instead of shaking hands and saying, God, I hope everything's well with you, they said, well, I hope everything's well with you. Here you go. Okay? That's what they did. Now, what was Leary's advice to America's youth? Okay, he's got some advice for America's youth. What is it? Anybody know? His advice to America's youth? Great. What's his advice?
Do drugs.
Kind of. Wait, you're reading it. Read it. What's his advice? Turn on, tune in, and drop out. That was his advice to America's youth. Turn on, tune in, and drop out. Now, you might think this guy didn't have much going for him, but in the time, he became pretty darn famous, and he spent the last 20 years of his life doing what? Making pretty good money doing both. What's that? Writing and selling, writing, and what else do you do to make money? Bill Clinton makes about $100,000 an hour doing it. Speaking. Very good. So Leary spent the last 20 years of his life writing and lecturing all across the United States in support of the use of LSD, making pretty good money while doing so. Spent the last 20 years of his life writing and lecturing across the United States. Unfortunately, on May 31st of 1996, he died of prostate cancer. On May 31st, 1996, Timothy Leary dies of prostate cancer. Well, what did I say he was born? 1920? 76? Died of prostate cancer on May 31st, 1996. He was cremated, and his remains were launched into space on February 9th, 1997. He died of prostate cancer on May 31st, 1996, and his cremated remains were launched into space on February 9th, 1997. Not sure exactly how they did that. That makes my curiosity up. I'm going to find out. But they launched it into space. So how many of the five have we covered?
Four.
The last one is rock music, both individuals and groups. Rock music were the final factor that led to the drug culture in the 1960s. Rock music, both individuals and groups. And we kind of talked about this a little bit, but I'll just make a point or two on rock music. As I mentioned, a lot of drug messages were commonly transferred through the lyrics of music during the decade. Okay? A lot of drug messages. That was what a lot of the songs, and there were, some of them were supposed to be kind of subliminal, so to speak. You're not supposed to really pick them up unless you really listen carefully, or maybe you'd hear them better if you were what? High, under the influence of something. Okay? The Beatles were famous for some of that. They were also famous for hiding lyrics on their records, which we'll talk about later. Okay? Now, the thing that made the drug culture, rock music part of the drug culture, is a lot of these rock stars, whether they were individual rock stars or were members of a group, were very visible drug abusers and, quote, role models for the younger generation of Americans. Okay? I can't think of anything that Justin Bieber might tell you girls that went to the concert, you might even think about doing it, because he's a positive role model for you. So if he told you to stand on your head at the concert, I bet you'd have done it. Well, unfortunately, in the 60s, students began to model these rock stars as heroes and began to live the life they were living. And they were abusing drugs, taking drugs. You know, I think, and we'll get into this, I think about the Rolling Stones and Keith. You know who Keith Richards is of the Rolling Stones, guitar player? The guy must be 75. I don't know how the hell he lived that long. We got people that are passing away, unfortunately, every day, and this guy took every drug, and I mean, he must be totally petrified inside, and he's almost 80 years old and still plays today. It makes you wonder how that happens. But anyway, he's one that was an incredible drug abuser. And we'll talk about this later, but a lot of these drug abusers abused a little bit too hard and end up losing their life. So the last thing we're going to get into today, and we'll get a little ways here, is famous and infamous rockers during the 1960s. Okay? Famous and infamous rockers during the 1960s. And who's the first one we're going to talk about? Janis Joplin. Very good. I think I forgot to put that little subtopic on there, didn't I? Yeah. Famous and infamous rockers during the 1960s. Put it wherever you'd like. And we're going to spend some time here today and then Tuesday going through several different rock individuals and rock groups that you've probably heard of and tell you a little bit more about them in detail. So you should have a good rock history of the 60s by the time we get done. Okay, we'll talk about Janis Joplin. Seriously, how many people have heard of Janis Joplin? Raise your hand if you've heard of her. You might not know a lot about her, but if you've heard her. Okay, and what do you know about her? Anybody know anything about her specifically? Her hair?
Yeah.
Okay. What's that? Looks like a man, kind of? You know, that might make, we might make a point on that. But she was kind of wild, wasn't she? She a little bit wild? We'll tell you a little bit about her. She was born in 1943 in Port Arthur, Texas. She was born in 1943 in Port Arthur, Texas. Now, Anybody know anything about Port Arthur, Texas? Guessing not. It's a pretty typical, clean, middle-class town. And Janice really enjoyed her elementary school years going to school there at Port Arthur, Texas. It was a very commonplace town, middle-class town, clean town, nice little town people like to live in. And during her experience from kindergarten, so to speak, I don't know if she went to kindergarten, but her elementary years through sixth grade, seventh grade, eighth grade, she had a pretty enjoyable experience. Well, her high school years were not real positive. She didn't enjoy those at all. What happens is when you get into high school, especially I think with girls, you start to mature. Different things happen. Her classmates treated her very poorly. She had a lot of acne issues. She had what was considered an underdeveloped body in comparison to her peers. And she took a lot of grief from classmates because of her acne, underdeveloped body, etc. So what do kids do that get ostracized like that in high school? What do they tend to do? What's that? One more time. Well, they might turn to music, but they usually end up, and it's in this school too, you see many different types of groups of kids here, right? Okay, those that are maybe really into drama, those that are maybe into sports, maybe those that are into something you don't want to mention. Well, what she did is she got around kids that began to feel like she felt, and they began to rebel against her hometown. So she ended up, because of the way she was treated by classmates in high school, she found a common group of friends, those types of people that were getting the same treatment, and she began to rebel against her hometown. Now, she was kind of a rebel. They didn't, Port Arthur, Texas wasn't too far from Louisiana. And so her and her friends used to go to Louisiana often, get drunked up, and what type of music did they listen to? Because Aaron has a point here. No? What's in Louisiana? What's in the South, the Bayou? What kind of music? Well, but what nationality type music? Black music. So you're right, but that's true. So what they did is they went down to Louisiana, and they drank and listened to black music. And what's probably the most famous type of black music other than jazz? It's a color. The blues, okay? So she fell in love with the blues music. And it sparked an interest in Janis Joplin that she might want to be a musician. So her and her friends, all that are kind of being ostracized in high school, start traveling down to Louisiana and listening to black music, and she falls in love with a specific type called the blues. And it sparks an interest in Janis in becoming a musician. Well, she graduates from high school in 1960, and she enrolls at college at Lamar Tech, small school. Lamar Tech. Graduates in 1960, and enrolls in a small college known as Lamar Tech in Texas. Didn't really like Lamar Tech, so she decided to enroll at the University of Texas in the School of Art. So she leaves Lamar Tech and she enrolls at the University of Texas in Austin, enrolls in the School of Art there. And she didn't really like that much. And so she left and went where? Come on, let the light bulb come on. Haight-Ashbury, very good. So she leaves the University of Texas after a short period of time. And she joins the hippie scene, so to speak, at Haight-Ashbury. Well, there she performs gigs at local coffee houses and bars. What's a gig? A small performance. I'm going to go and do a couple gigs here. Got a little music group going. We're going to do a couple gigs at a couple bars here. They're going to pay us probably while we can drink and maybe a little bit of cash, or all we can smoke and a little bit of cash, depending on her situation. But she began to get interested in music, got some kids together, and they did some gigs at local coffee houses and bars. Okay? And then she joined a musical group known as Big Brother and the Holding Company. She joins a musical group known as Big Brother and the Holding Company. And this is really what started her career off as a famous musician, is when she got an opportunity to join a group called Big Brother and the Holding Company. And they became very, very famous. They played like at Madison Square Garden in New York. And where else did they play some big rock concert? Woodstock. Okay, so Big Brother and the Holding Company was a very famous group at the time. They were given gigs, although they weren't considered gigs at that point, in such famous sites as Madison Square Garden, and performed also at Woodstock. Now, what happens in many cases, she tours and records with Big Brother and the Holding Company, and who starts to pay attention to her because she's a lead singer? Everybody. And it causes resentment among the other members of the group. So the media falls in love with this gal because of her style of singing. And what happened is the band itself became littler and littler and littler, and Joplin became bigger and bigger and bigger. And it caused a tremendous rift among the members of the group. So what we'll do on Tuesday is we'll tell you what happened with her career after that, and then I'm going to show you a video on Janis Joplin, which I think you'll enjoy, so we can lecture and video a little bit on that long period, and I think you'll enjoy that. Okay, so we'll tell you what happens with Janis Joplin, and then I'm going to show you a video on Janis Joplin. Okay, nice job.